start with my topic for today, long-term ventilation, without wasting a moment. At the outset, I would like to summarize my talk briefly. This is about a child who was with us for a period of roughly 16 months. He was on assisted ventilation since birth, and today we will discuss his journey and challenges faced during the course of our PICU stay. This child was born as a preterm, 30-weeker, 1.3 kg. He had respiratory distress syndrome at birth, for which he was intubated and received surfactant. He was extubated to nasal prongs on day 8. After that, till 2 months, he had persistent oxygen need. Still, he was on oxygen by nasal prongs till 2 months of age. During this period, he had recurrent episodes of bronchospasm, which were treated symptomatically with intermittent HFNC and bronchodilators. At around 7 months of age, he had probable aspiration episode, for which he was intubated again and ventilated for around 3 weeks. Echo done outside was showing pulmonary hypertension, and he was progressively started on sildenafil and bosentan. Mm-hmm. At 8 months of age, he was again re-intubated, query aspiration or the query hypoxic seizure episode. This was the course in the outside hospital at Trichy. They were able to extubate the child even after 3 weeks of intubation. So for further management, he was referred to our hospital. This slide will summarize his total issues and the problems, which he had hyaline membrane disease, which was since the time of the birth, which later on progressed to chronic lung disease, which was throughout the stay. Currently, he is of 2 years of age. And he had aspiration episodes multiple times during this the initial, which at 3 months and 9 months around, for which he was intubated. He had the second episode with hypoxic seizures also. Bronchospasm was intermittent initially, the first episode, which was started around 4th month of age around, and pulmonary artery hypertension, which was there first diagnosed at the age of around 6 months, and it is persisting. Before discharge, he was noted to have no pulmonary hypertension in the repeat echo. He had multiple episodes of recurrent bronchospasm, which were like continuously, it was coming on weekly duration. And there were few severe life-threatening episodes during our PICU stay at multiple times. To count, at least 6 times he had severe life-threatening bronchospasm episodes. Ventilation-wise, we received the child at 6 months. That was the hypoxic, 8 months around. It was at the hypoxia and the seizure induced. And then this child was ventilated till 22nd to 23rd month of age. He underwent also gastrostomy and tracheostomy, which was also done around 9 months of age, and he's still on a gastrostomy feeding Mickey button tube. So coming to the challenges faced during PICU stay, we had multiple, given the long-term ventilation for around 16 months, we had a lot of issues with the child, difficult to manage. All the issues I have outlined here, he had recurrent life-threatening bronchospasm. He had related to that, he had this modified asthma therapy to treat all these life-threatening bronchospasm, difficulty in weaning, and prevention from the hospital infection and inconsistencies due to COVID between healthcare providers, GRD and feed intolerance, and the general pediatrics in ICU. We'll discuss one by one. The initial problem was recurrent life-threatening bronchospasm. So long time admission, initially always multiple episode of bronchospasm. In case of emergencies, the line were all wasted out. There were a lot of difficulty in getting lines. So, and also this all treatments he became resistant to normal, like usual measures, he was like almost resistant to normal salbutamol or beta agonist or Magnesulf or adrenaline. We had a modified device, Anaconda also we got it, which is a anesthetic device in case of emergency when we don't have any measures to control the bronchospasm to calm the child, because there was a vicious cycle in which he will become irritable and more excessive cry will happen, which will lead to hypoxia and further bronchospasm will worsen. So this was a vicious cycle. So to calm the child, we had to procure Anaconda, a special delivery device, which was made. And the other issue had been not able to taper and stop steroids. So child was on long-term steroid therapy for all these episodes. So to counter all these things, what we did, there was a modified asthma therapy. It is highly customized and individualized therapy. It's not to be implied to everyone. Difficult IV access in case of emergencies. Emergency exacerbation plan was forwarded and placed at the bedside in case of emergency to manage this child. Low dose steroids were continued, not a very high dose. Initially, he received high dose, but later on low dose steroids were continued for a very long time. This is the format, like just it is highly individualized again, I will say. So to make him this vicious cycle of irritability, crying and hypoxia, and then again further worsening of bronchospasm, we just tried pediclodyl oral ketamine also through the gastrostomy tube or the IM route. And the midazolam also oral was kept. This was pasted bedside in case of emergency. Whenever it did, any night people duty or daytime people, we imply all these measures during that time. The other issue was difficulty in weaning. So he failed weaning from mechanical ventilation. He was admitted at 8 months of life in our PICU. And then again, due to repeated failure extubation attempts, he underwent tracheostomy. And I was continued on mechanical ventilation for around 16 months from May 2020 when he was admitted to our hospital and till September 2021. He failed weaning multiple times till May 2021. From May 2021 till that time, we were trying to reach the normal very fast. We were trying to cut down when he becomes stable, we'll try to wean him very fast. So from that time, we realized that a protocolized weaning protocol should be formatted. So that a very step-by-step approach and a very gradual approach was implemented for this. And implying this protocolized weaning, which was started in May 2021, we are able to make the child on room air by the start of the August 2021. So this was the weaning plan when we implemented from May around. So we made the two prescriptions. I'll not go in much in detail. Prescription one is the more of the mechanical ventilation. Prescription two is the more of the support mode with the CPAP. So this was the weaning chart, which was modified day by day. This is just an example of the weaning chart, how we tapered. So you can make out like every day, like some 2 to 3 days interval, 5 minute duration we... Prescription was the ventilation one. So we reduced the 15 minutes. So we gave a break. This whole duration is for 12 hours. And every day disconnection time also we increased gradually. Low dose steroids were the key. They were also continued during all this period. Later on 0.2 mg every day. So this all weaning, gradual weaning with a formatted plan helped to get out of the mechanical ventilation and wean successfully by the start of the August month. Other challenges which were faced were prevention with infection. Obviously, the child had a separate room for himself in the PICU. Strict restriction to the visitors, minimal handling was followed. It was isolated, as I told. COVID precautions, actually COVID came as a blessing in disguise. People were much aware about the social distancing, hand hygiene, mask, forcing the child to get a secondary infection. And obviously a lot of luck was required during all this long-term stay of 1.5 years almost. What were the other challenges faced? It was inconsistencies due to COVID between the healthcare providers. We know all this 2 lockdowns and almost everyone doing shifts. So there was already reduction in the manpower. One sister was always all the time to assign a sister was a difficult job. And new person at every shift, because everybody was coming at minimum 2 to 3 gaps of interval, doctors, sisters. So they were not knowing what to do next time. Weekly rotation of consultants also happening daily, means every week alternate, some new consultant will come. So how we tackled with this, we updated a daily handover sheet, which will be daily made up, what progress is happening, what plan will be there, and it will be duly posted in our group, so that every consultant and every doctors and duty fellows should be updated what is the plan. Every night we used to make a telegram call where all the consultants and all the fellows will be joining and we'll discuss about all the cases and about him also for all the details that what will be the plan later. And emergency plan with protocol were printed and pasted bedside, as I showed you the example prior. The other issue was gastroesophageal reflux disease and the feed intolerance. He had acute exacerbation due to microaspirations. So he underwent gastrostomy and fundoplication for him. Now, second, what problem we had following this, the child was growing and we also targeted weight gain for him, but the child had reduced gastric capacity post gastrostomy. So all the time when we wanted to increase the feeds or when we wanted to increase the amount of feed and whenever we want to apply this bolus feed, child had stomach pain and other issues which will lead to further exacerbation of the and microaspiration and exacerbation of the bronchospasm. So to tackle all these things, we had dietitian involved, a programmed and protocolized pattern was in, was made inclusive exclusively for the child. Pediatric surgeons were involved. Venting for leaking out gas from the gastrostomy tube and all was all implemented. The other important aspect of this is EICU. So in PICU, we generally get over the general pediatrics, but since the child was 1.5 year, we had to look out other disciplines also. So there was a multidisciplinary approach for the immunization. We continued with the routine exam immunization, and special immunizations also were procured for him. Palivizumab was procured for him. Because a single bout of RSV infection or any other bronchitis would have been life-threatening for him. Physiotherapy and occupational therapy were continued side by side. Dietitian had a very important role in weight gain and other feed intolerance issues. Speech and language pathologist for sensory and oromotor stimulation and training. As the child was not fed orally for almost a year, more than a year. So he started to have an aversion towards the whatever given through the oral route. So swallowing therapy side by side was also initiated. And the child on, since on tracheostomy, this is speech part, for that we procured a speaking wall. So that child, which was used during the daytime alone, and the child progressively was monitored for the speaking abilities. Other departments also contributed, ENT for the hearing screening, ophthalmologist for the squint the child had, neurology for the general gross development, and the pediatric surgery for the gastrostomy and other related problems. So at the time of admission development, the child was recognizing mother and follows light. Currently at the time of discharge, he has social smile, recognizes parents, waves bye-bye, holds hand for namaste, gives high five, sits with support. And above all, what mattered was patient parents' perseverance, and a lot of money was invested. As I told already, child had an isolated cubicle with 1.5 months of PICU stay. Coming to this is the pics photo gallery from the child from the first birthday in PICU. This is in the 5th month of PICU admission. And this is the first birthday. In the child, we can make out the tracheostomy is in there and he's on the ventilator. The first birthday was celebrated. The second day, this was between first to second birthday. This was before discharge on rounds in the PICU. This is the picture with a speaking wall. He was able to speak the generate words, letters from this speaking wall later. Bag full of documents of 1.5 year stay shown by our fellow.
This is turn right onto 7th Cross Street.
Intermittent phase where he was like on the ventilator, and again this is the second birthday at home, and this was a pre-discharge second birthday before, just 4 to 5 days prior to this, on the eve of Janmashtami he was at home. And this is our PICU team, which all contributed to safely discharge this time. The child is currently at home and doing well. One acute episode landed him in our PICU for 4 to 5 days, but again, he's home for more than 1 month. He's doing well right now. That's all.
Thank you, Dr. Tanay.